Is I want you to find how many times, and just begin to count the number of times that you see the word joy. So for every time you see the word joy, you get a point for that, okay? Now, if you want to get some extra credit on that, if you see the word joy and you're kind of technologically savvy, and you can either tweet that to me, or you can Facebook it to our church, or you can send me an email or a message and just take a picture of the word joy. You get 5 points for that. Everybody but Joy, your wife. Like, she can't, like, write her name down a lot and win this. But kind of get some points for this. And just, I want you to see how many times you see the word joy. It is absolutely everywhere. Last night we were at Target, just walking down an aisle. And there's these letters just hanging up, like the unpainted letters, joy. You can buy each one of them. You know, I don't know what you do with just a J or an O or a Y, but you can buy every one of them. If you're like really, really rich, at Lowe's, I got a special right now, I guess now $1,200, you can buy some very large blow-up letters of joy. $1,200, like that would steal my joy just buying it, I mean, to you. Who would think they're on sale for $720 now, but because nobody would pay $1,200 for that. $700, like, who would pay that for that? You're going to see the word joy everywhere. Like, you get extra credit if you want to send out Christmas cards with the letter joy on it, you like, or the word joy on it. Like, that would... Can you imagine how joy is everywhere? Why is joy so associated with Christmas? There is something that we wish everyone that is close to joy, it's a synonym of joy, we wish them a what? A Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas is, you know, glad tidings, and it's joy. And it's like, why is it that everywhere we see are the words joy and glad tidings and Merry Christmas, and yet for many, this is probably the least joyful time of year. For many, their Christmas is full of stress. It's the leading time of depression in America. And so for many, they have nothing, they don't even see joy in their life. Here is my hope. Here is what I'm praying for. That we would understand joy, but more than that, we would experience joy this Christmas. Like, it would be this deep, abiding sense of joy. Would say, I now get it. I want that. And I have that. And so let's pray for that here today. God, would you open up my mouth, but would you open up our ears and our hearts that we could receive from you what only you can give. You're the only one that can give us joy. And we turn to you and pray that for your help. I pray that you would anoint my words, open up your word to us, that we can understand this. And more than that, God, I pray that we could come to the realization of where we're at with you and what we either have or don't have in our life. So would you teach us this? Would you help us in this? We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our passage today, one of them is from, I like what Rob shared, by the way, with the wise men. It said they were overjoyed. Can you imagine? There's this joy that's absolutely overflowing. And did you see the connection? When they were overjoyed, they fell down in worship. What you'll find in Scripture is that worship and joy go together. Whatever you worship in life will bring joy to you. Can I say that again? Whatever you worship in life, that's the source where you get joy. Now, if you worship something that's not the true source of joy, your joy will be only momentary. But whatever you worship, that connection between joy and worship is so tight. So if you worship your family, you might feel joy for a little bit, but it's fleeting, it goes away. So you don't want our families to be the object of our worship. If you worship a sports team like the Cubs, every 108 years you get a chance to feel this fleeting thing of we call joy. Have you noticed that in joy, when you experience it, there's one type of joy that does something to your body. Like, have you heard the words, cry tears of joy? Or they broke out in joyful dancing, or there's singing kind of joys, or he jumped for joy. Now, a lot of times when somebody experiences this type of joy, then it affects their body. If something comes out of their body when they experience this type of joy. So that moment, literally, that moment when the Cubs won the World Series, what did every single player do in the next second? There was a leap that happened. Like, they just... they couldn't control it. They began to jump because there was joy began to do that to them. Have you experienced a joy that does that in your life? That literally affects you, that makes you sing, makes you cry, makes you dance, makes you jump. In the Psalms, it talks about shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. That there's this joy that absolutely overwhelms. And wouldn't you want to experience that kind of joy? In Luke chapter 2, begins to make the association between Christmas and joy. In Luke chapter 2, it says, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger. Do you see the connection in this passage? What brought the joy? The joy was brought because of this great news that was passed out. So they got great news, and that great news brought great joy. Have you experienced that in your life? Perhaps one day you hear the words that you have cancer, and then another day you hear the great news that you are cancer-free. It's great news. Something comes out. The shout comes out. That there's this joy that's associated with great news. Do you know that for there to be great news in our life, do what you have to have? You have to have bad news before it. I mean, almost always there's bad news before the great news. And, you know, like I said, if you receive the word that you have cancer, it's great news when you're cancer-free. You know what the bad news of the gospel was? The bad news was that every one of us needed a Savior. The great news is that there is one. If you want to experience joy, the place to get it is the only one that can give lasting, true inner joy. And that's Jesus Christ. He is the only one that can produce this kind of joy in our life. All the other kinds of joys are fleeting. You're joyful for a moment. You're excited for a little bit of time. You have great hope. And then that begins to wane away. But there's great news today. If you want some lasting joy, begin to ask God for that. Begin to say, God, I need that kind of peace in my life. I need that kind of joy. Would you supply it? It talks about in Galatians, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is, once we receive Jesus Christ as Lord, His first gift to us is the Holy Spirit. When He pours this out upon us, look at this. It says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and the next verse will be gentleness and self-control. This is the fruit of the Spirit. By the way, where does fruit come from? Most of the time, trees. It can come from vines. But where does it come from before that? Like a seed. So a seed is planted, And when the seed's planted, then you begin to nurture it. Do you get fruit the first day you plant the seed? No. And it's the same way with the Spirit of God. Maybe you don't experience this joy or this peace or this patience, but the seeds are in them. And once you begin to water it, you begin to tend it, it begins to grow, and you begin to receive the fruit of the Spirit. And one of the first aspects of the Spirit that we get is this joy, this incredible joy. Can I give you a definition of joy? There's two different kinds of joy, and we need to distinguish between the two of them. There's one kind of joy that I call it acute joy. Acute means it's short-lived. It comes for just a little bit of time, and that's the kind that you get, again, when like the Cubs win the World Series, or when there's some good news that you get in life, or you got an AM test, or something, and it produces within you this acute kind of joy. That feels so good. But there's this other kind of joy that's a deep, abiding sense of joy that comes no matter what. You don't have to have good news to get this kind of joy. In fact, this kind of joy goes throughout our life no matter what the news is or no matter what's going on in our life. Here's something I'd like you to practice this week and begin to realize it. I want you to go back to your life and just pick a year, any year of your life. Maybe it's some year that you had in junior high school or a year that you had in college, but just pick a year, 1983. I don't know, just pick a year. And then ask yourself this question. What was the most joyful thing that happened to me in that year? And just begin to think about it. You know, it might take a little bit of time to kind of go through things and find something that was joyful in that year. And then I want you to ask the second question. What was one of the harder things that I went through that year? And you would think that the most joyful thing that happened to you in that year, 1983, would be the opposite of the most difficult thing that happened to you in that year. But you know what I found doing that this week? I just went one year by year. Just one year after another year after another year after another year. Now that many of the occasions, the most joyful event of my life came as a result of the most difficult thing in my life. Some of the most joyful things in my life were like they were tied to some of the most painful. I had to get that. And so there's this connection. Don't you feel like I heard this Christmas carol this week? Have yourself a merry little Christmas. You can think about it. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. What's the line that goes in there? I had to write it down, but I heard it this week. From now on, your troubles will be far away. From that is the way in which we get happiness, is when our troubles are far away, then I can finally be joyful. When my troubles are far away, then I can be happy. And I want to tell you, it's just the opposite. Probably the most joyful experiences of our life come through the most difficult times of our lives. I don't know how it works, but God seems to do it in the middle of that. And so I want you to take the test. Just begin to go through your life and go, wow, this was a very joyful time in my life. How did that come about? And it's probably as a result of some of the most difficult times. Jesus taught his disciples a lot about joy. In one of the last nights of his life, in John chapter 15, verse 11, he tells them the reason why he taught them that night. He got them together and he says, I've told you this so that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. Where do we get joy? It's Jesus' joy may be in us, and that would grow to a place of maturity. And so Jesus' teaching from that night was all about how in which we get this joy, that joy can be complete. The previous passage before it, in John chapter 14, he gives this lesson to them. It says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. Or believe in God. believe also in me. The last night of Jesus' life, did you know that for every one of those disciples who heard that, the most troubling day of all would be the very next day? There would be no other day in life that they would have greater difficulty than the next 24 hours when Jesus Christ was crucified, the song, buried, and all that. And he says to them, don't let your hearts be troubled. This is a great secret of joy, is that right in the middle of troubles, to not let your heart get troubled. Right in the middle of troubles, saying, God, I choose to trust you. I want you to think of our life more like railroad tracks. It's not like it's a roller coaster where we're up and down, up and down, and up and down. Instead, it's more like railroad tracks where there's times that there's great joy, but right next to that, there's times of great difficulty. It's not that the good times come and the bad times go away. The good times and the bad times are right next to one another. It's saying, God, I'm going to trust you in the middle of that. So here's my definition of joy. I believe that joy is the deep, abiding sense that God is in control. The deep, abiding belief that no matter what happens, God is in control. I choose to believe that. I choose to trust that. God is in control. I can trust him. And when we begin to do that, there's a joy that comes in our life. And there's no other way to get it than that place of saying, God, I trust you, and I know that you're in control. Can you trust him? Can you trust him with anything on in your life? You know what the opposite of that is? When you don't trust him, you begin to worry. And when you begin to worry, you begin to do things. And when you begin to worry and try to do things, then you lose your joy. We can trust him. We can trust him that no matter what happens, God is in control and he can be trusted. There's a woman in our church. Do you know Phyllis Lundy? Phyllis is nearly, she's on full-time pain pumps right now to control her cancer. 100% of the time, day and night, this pain goes through her, pain medications go through her body, and she's constantly on that. I was visiting her in the last week, and as I was talking to her, she said these words, this is going to be the best Christmas ever. This is going to be the best Christmas ever. Do you know anything about Phyllis? Her heart is broken about Bridget and all of the things going on. And probably the one least likely to say, this is going to be the best Christmas ever. But she puts us to shame. She absolutely puts us to shame because she has no reason to believe that this is going to be the best Christmas ever. But she believes it. And you can see it in her face. You can see you believe it when you talk to her. You know what's sad is that there are many of us that have all kinds of reasons to believe that this is going to be the best Christmas ever. And yet, in the middle of all that, we aren't. We're not experiencing joy. We're not experiencing his peace. Two scriptures that I want to share in closing from Philippians. Philippians is literally the book of joy. If you want to learn how to walk in joy, Philippians tells you the secrets of walking in joy. First of all, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14, if you want to experience joy, do this. Do everything without grumbling or complaining, or without complaining or arguing. This spirit of arguing and complaining will absolutely sap any kind of joy in our life. And just cut it out. It's got to be stopped. Do you know why? Because at the very same time that you're complaining or you're arguing with somebody, there's all kinds of reasons to be experiencing joy. But where's your mind? Your mind is on all of those other things. So when you're complaining and arguing and not at peace with people, then you begin to lose your joy. After the first service, somebody came up to me and their face was literally beaming with joy. And she said, I did it. I'm like, what'd you do? It's like, well, for many, many years, my brother and I have not been together. We have talked they'll be reconciled. And she began to describe how they reconciled that. She said, when I was on Facebook, I would see friend suggestions, and my brother's name would always be at the top of the list. I would never click on it. But I remember your messages on forgiveness over and over again. And so I clicked on that, and my brother responded almost immediately. And then we called, and we talked, and she said, I feel like a 500-pound weight is off of me. She said that to her brother. He said, I feel like a 500-pound weight is off of me. And so the mom feels like a 1,000-pound weight is off of her. And when there's like contention between us and somebody else, you forfeit the joy that could be yours. Just absolutely forfeit it. And so if you're serious about this, if you'd like to have this deep, abiding sense of joy, then complaining's got to stop. And arguing with others has got to stop. And forgiveness has to take place. And that's just the next step. Also in Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, is one of the only commands in the Bible that's repeated. And this will be a part of this message every single week. Rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoicing. To translate it, it's to praise God. Here's a better way to translate it. Maybe a different way, not a better way. A way, enjoy the Lord always. Enjoy the Lord always. I will say it again, enjoy Him. Enjoy Him. You don't have to be afraid to enjoy life. You don't have to be afraid to enjoy God. It gives Him glory when you enjoy Him. There is a catechism is a way in which people teach theology. The Westminster Shorter Catechism begins in this way. It says, what is the chief purpose of human beings? It's to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. To glorify God and enjoy Him forever. God wants us to enjoy Him. We glorify Him when we enjoy Him. We glorify Him when we enjoy life, when we begin to see joy in life, and we don't let things steal our joy, and we don't try to steal the joy of others, and we live life the way that produces joy within us. Enjoy Him, enjoy Him, enjoy Him. It matters so much. Can you imagine if you bought a gift for a little child, and you tried to pick out exactly the gift that the child wanted, and the child unwrapped it, and then the child looked at it and go, oh, okay, and just kind of put it to the side. What would that make you feel in that? It wouldn't make you feel good, would it? It wouldn't make you feel like you love them or you cared for them. What would be the thing that you would most want the child to do when he unwraps the gift or she unwraps the gift? Show their joy. You just would want to watch them play with the toy and just enjoy it and experience that. And it's the same way with life. God wants to watch us enjoy Him. He doesn't want us to get so distracted with some of the things that we enjoy that we don't think of Him. But He wants us to enjoy Him. He wants us to get joy in Him. And so it's so important that we do this. I don't know where you go, and everywhere you go, there's this one person we call it Eeyore. Have you ever been in Eeyore? Eeyore is, hey, how you doing? Oh, it's okay. Life's kind of tough. It's kind of rough. And, you know? And what do you want to do when you meet an Eeyore? Don't you want to just kind of... You want to slap them or go the other way? Or it's like... I'm not trying to say, because I have prayed with and talked with like widows who are experiencing their first Christmas. I'm not saying that life is always like great. What I'm saying is there's always greatness in life. There's always something worth enjoying. And even in the times when you are at your worst, and it is the, you know, saying, I absolutely hate everything about my life right now, you can find joy in that. And God wants us to find joy in that. So this week, our task is to be out looking for joy, be looking for the words of having fun, looking for the outer displays of joy. And you kind of have a contest with that. Somebody's going to get some cake balls out of that. On the bulletin, everybody gets a point if you can see on the bulletin. So I want you to have fun with that. But perhaps the moment you see the word joy somewhere, could you ask yourself, am I experiencing joy right now? Like, is there that deep, abiding sense of joy in me right now? And God, I want that. I do something happy. I want to experience that. So I want to pray for us, God. We want to glorify you and enjoy you this week. We look at our lives and see so many blessings that you've given. Praise you for that. Yes, there are difficulties that are all around us. But God, we don't want to get so wrapped up.